So welcome to my Coursera course. Today we'll be talking about counseling theory, or ways to reach out to our deeply troubled patients. So what's your mood like today?
Are you going to pay for these?
Welcome to Advanced International Business. In the not-too-distant future, the global economy is going to be dominated by the BRIC countries. Brazil.
As a technologist and as a photographer, I'm here to teach you how to take your own picture, or as the students call it, a selfie.
Guys, come over here. Have you seen this?
My name is Joseph Aoun. Some of you know me as a linguist, some others as the president of Northeastern University. But my real passion and my real specialty is yodeling. Let's start!
I'm wondering if we should show Daphne before April 3rd.
No.
I went across to Switzerland where all the yodelers.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Daphne Koller.
Thank you, everyone, and that's much more entertaining than the rest of this will be, so you might want to step out now. And it even beat our April Fool's joke, which I don't know how many of you saw the basket weaving course, so. Underwater basket weaving. So thank you everyone for being here, and thank you President Aoun for the invitation and for that wonderful video. So the title of this talk is The Online Revolution, Education for Everyone. I'm going to start and end with Education for Everyone, and the online revolution is going to be sandwiched in the middle. So back in January of 2012, just as we were starting Coursera, an incident happened that really drove home to us why we were doing this. This incident, although hopefully unique, is emblematic of a very broad problem, where in many countries in the developing world, there just is insufficient capacity for the growing number of students who want and deserve a higher education. South Africa is one such country where the system of higher education was devised in the days of apartheid for the white minority. And as a consequence, now the accept rate among qualified applicants in South Africa's top public universities is about 1 in 8. So in January, in the University of Johannesburg, when the admissions process had completed, there was a handful of slots that had not been claimed. And so they were about to reopen admissions to a next round. The night before that was due to happen, there was a line of people literally a mile long standing outside the gate looking to be first in line to get one of those coveted positions. And when the gates opened in the morning, there was a stampede, and 20 people were badly injured and one woman died. She was the mother of a son, and you could say that she literally died trying to give her son a chance at a better life. So this, as I said, is a really unique tragedy and one that we hope doesn't get replicated very often, but the lack of capacity in many countries in the developing world is very much a problem going forward. So that's one problem. If we come closer to home, we have a different problem. Here, capacity doesn't seem to be much of an issue. If you really need a place at an institution, there is a place for you. But we have the other problem, which is the one of cost. So here you see a graph where on the x-axis is time going back to 1985, cost of different types of goods. At the top, where you would expect it, is medical care, except that it isn't. At the very top is college tuition and fees. Now, admittedly, a very large part of the reason for this graph is the defunding of public education that many states have engaged in over the last 20 years, reducing subsidies and giving rise to an increase in tuition. But for whatever the reason, the fact is that many people now find higher education increasingly out of reach. So After we launched this effort in April of 2012, Tom Friedman wrote up about this, and Tom has quite a way with words, and he put it better, really, than anyone else ever had before, where he said that big breakthroughs are what happen when what is suddenly possible meets what is desperately necessary. The desperately necessary are the first two slides. The suddenly possible was this radical experiment that Stanford put together in the fall of 2011. That some of you, I'm sure, had heard of. This was an experiment where three graduate-level courses in computer science were placed on the web and opened up for everyone around the world to take for free. So we were expecting an enrollment of a few thousand people, graduate-level in computer science, how many people would be interested? Within a matter of weeks, each of these had an enrollment of about 100,000 students or more. So to put that number in perspective, the largest of these courses as taught at Stanford has an enrollment of about 400, considered large even by Stanford standards. When that course, the machine learning course, had an enrollment of 100,000 students, in order to reach that same size audience, my colleague Andrew, who teaches that course, would need to teach his course at Stanford for 250 years. And by doing so, he would reach 250 generations of very privileged Stanford students, as opposed to the many, many people from diverse backgrounds who got the privilege of taking his course in this online form. So I think this really created and clarified an opportunity that we had to affect really significant change in the world. And so, and as a consequence of that, in January 2012, we, as I said, launched this effort. And as of now, we have, this is a slide that's impossible to keep updated, 62 universities, 333 courses, close to 3.2 million students at this point, and a number that blows my mind: every month, 1.45 million people click on the enroll button, which is really a very large amount of education that one can offer to people. So let me talk a little bit about each of these numbers. These are the U.S. institutions that are partnering with us. The non-U.S. are coming up on the next slide. You can see here most of the nation's top private institutions, Princeton, Penn, and Stanford, who are among our first university partners, Caltech, Duke, Columbia, Brown, and so on and so forth. Many of this country's top public institutions, several of the UCs, four of the UCs, University of Michigan, one of our first partners, University of Washington, Wisconsin, North Carolina, Minnesota, and so on and so forth. These are the 24 non-U.S. institutions that are partnering with us. We now have institutions on four continents in North America, including two from Mexico, so Latin America, Australia, Asia, and Europe. We're able to offer courses in five languages. In addition to English, there's French that is currently running, offering basic introductory programming courses to people in sub-Saharan Africa, some of the poorest countries in the world. Spanish coming up in a couple of months, Chinese and Italian. And we're hoping to add more languages later on. This is in addition to the fact that many of our courses are subtitled in different languages. So again, you can see here some of this world's top universities in Europe and Asia, and in other countries as well. The courses, the 333 courses, span the range of disciplines. People keep thinking about us as a computer science endeavor because we started out there, but that's not actually true anymore. You can see here courses in philosophy, in global challenges and sustainability, in business, in astrobiology, in performance music, performance art, pretty much everything that you can think of is now represented on this platform in one of our offered by one of our university partners. Let me talk a little bit about the 3.1 million students. So here's some access stories that we have gotten, and these are just a very small sampling. I could stand here for an hour and tell stories about people whose lives were transformed. This is Raul. Raul is from Peru. There isn't much computer science education to speak of in Peru. He took a bunch of the computer science courses from that we were able to offer, used that as the basis for a Fulbright application, and is now coming to study in the United States. Jolene is from Pakistan. She took the intro sociology class. She was inspired by what she learned and with a fellow student in the class founded an NGO, and they're now together taking additional courses to learn how to run their NGO better. And Achint is from a small town in India, wanted to be an entrepreneur, took the Wharton gamification class, and is now participating in an All India Entrepreneurship Competition. Actually, just yesterday I got an email from one of our instructors at Penn who told me that a student from a tiny, tiny village in Pakistan who had taken the modern and contemporary American poetry class had just been accepted as an undergraduate student at the University of Pennsylvania on a full scholarship on the strength of his performance in that class, among other things. So it's really quite exciting, the doors that this opens to people. So these are the kinds of access stories that you might have predicted. This one, I think, is probably less expected. Daniel, sitting on the right, is a 17-year-old boy who's severely autistic. He has a speaking vocabulary of 150 words. He communicates by typing on an iPad that was designed for him by his father. And by doing so, he was the star student in that same modern contemporary American poetry class. That's Professor Al Fillery sitting on the left. Since then, he's taken about three or four of our other classes and done spectacularly well as well. And Daniel tells us that not only is this the first meaningful educational experience he's had after a life of special ed, but that this rigor and form factor of learning is actually helping to alleviate the severity of his disease. We get similar emails from other students with learning and cognitive disabilities. We also get emails from people with other types of health issues. So about a couple of months ago, we got an email from a woman who happens to be a Stanford alumna, actually, with stage 4 breast cancer, who says that she can't really leave the house except to go to the hospital to get her chemotherapy, and this is her one window into the outside world. So this is really an opportunity for people to have access to something that in the normal course of events they would never otherwise have. So now to the online revolution. What makes this different from other forms of open courseware? After all, 2001, MIT put out OCW, there's been Open Yale, iTunes U, and so on and so forth. What makes this different? The difference is that we have attempted to take and put in an online format something that feels to the students, even if they're scattered all over the world, as if they were on a college campus. So the course starts on a given day, and then every week there's material that the students are responsible for learning. And every week there's homework. And the homework is graded. So students know if they're actually learning the material or not. And if they don't do their homework, they don't get a grade. And if they don't get a grade, they don't pass the course. And you can see the impact of that on this usage graph. X-axis is time. Y-axis is number of users on site. Those little bars are deadlines. You see those little peaks? That's the day before the deadline. Except for that first peak you see over there where they try to do the day of the deadline, and obviously they learned their lesson and they now move to the day before the deadline. And then at the very end of the game, there is a credential of some kind that really is a testament to the student's ability to have mastered the material, and we'll talk a little bit about the form of that credential at the end. So let me talk now about the details of the student experience. So one of the things that happens is that when you move away from the constraints of in-class teaching, you can really let people get creative. So first of all, the instructors can get creative and become flexible because they're no longer supposed to be standing there in front of the class as they teach. So for example, the Illinois sustainability class shot a lot of the video on site in places where sustainability is much more clearly manifest. Bottom left is a really interesting experiment from the intro to sociology class from Princeton that I mentioned earlier, where in addition to the weekly lecture content, he had a Google Hangout. You can see it there. You can see all those little squares. These are students from the public class. There were about 8 of them, plus 2 Princeton students, and they had a discussion of the sociology question of the day. And because sociology is such a locally contextualized discipline, then the conversation was much more heterogeneous and varied than you would get in a normal on-campus class. And in fact, the professor, Mitch Denier, tells us that he learned more from teaching in this format to a global audience than he'd learned in 12 years of teaching at Princeton University. Because at Princeton, every year there's a great discussion, but every year it's about the same discussion as last year. And here it was just completely different, and it reshaped the way he thinks about his discipline. So in the interest of time, I'm going to skip past the other two examples and talk about the other aspect of flexibility, which is the student-side flexibility. First of all, by virtue of teaching online, we are no longer constrained by the one-hour block, which has been forced on us by room scheduling constraints. I mean, why do we teach in one-hour blocks? It's not a natural unit for either the material and certainly not for the students' attention spans. And so what we can do now, style con-like, is break down the video into much shorter segments that are better suited to the students' attention spans. 8 to 12 minutes is about right. And students can traverse this at their own time, at their own pace. And even more importantly, they can pause and rewind when they get confused. They can, even more importantly for the students at least, watch at double speed when the instructor is being boring. They tell us that. And rewind when they feel like they need to. You can now also start personalizing it in other ways. Some students might benefit from a refresher on a certain topic that not everyone needs. Some students might be interested in some extension material that is not of interest to everyone. And so you can really now break away from the one-size-fits-all model of education that has been forced on us by the need to teach to 100 people sitting in an auditorium. So that's the first pillar of the student experience in one of these courses, but perhaps it's the least interesting one. The one that I think is even more interesting is the ability to engage students and force them to interact with the material throughout the duration of the learning process. So there's a ton of research that demonstrates the benefits of that. I'm just going to talk about one study. This is from a science paper in 2011 by Karpikin and Blunt, and they studied different strategies for teaching people and showed that testing people, that is forcing them to retrieve stuff that they just learned, is a much more effective learning strategy in terms of down-the-line outcomes than many other ways of, for example, just passively reviewing the material. And so in order to implement that level of interactivity within an online platform, we did several things. First of all, even the video itself is not a passive thing. So here you can see what this looks like. And there is sound here, but we decided not to play it. You can see the instructor is talking. There is subtitles for accessibility in foreign language speakers. The video hits the yellow notch. The student gets asked a question,
status quo bias, submits. Base rate bias. They're all well-documented.
In this case, the answer was wrong. They get an opportunity to resubmit. In this case, the answer is right, and there's an optional explanation. Now, this is the kind of question that I, as an instructor, might ask in class, but when I ask it in class, I can tell you from personal experience, 80% of the students are still scribbling the last thing I said, because I speak pretty quickly. The ones whose laptops are open, they're not taking notes, they're on Facebook. And then there's the smarty pants in the front row, who blurts out the answer before the vast majority of the audience has even had a chance to realize that a question had been asked. And then, as an instructor, I'm terribly gratified that somebody actually knew the answer to my question, and the lecture moves on. And here, every single student engages with the material. Now, of course, these little baby questions in the middle of a lecture is not where the meaningful learning happens. These are simple retention questions, and they maintain engagement. But meaningful learning happens when students actually have to solve problems. So now we're faced with a dilemma. How do you grade the work of 100,000 students when you don't have 5,000 teaching assistants? Which Stanford, we asked, refused to pay for. So what do you do? First of all, you get the computer to grade for you. And fortunately, computers are actually pretty good now at grading a range of work. There is your good old multiple choice, the short answer questions that I showed in the video. You can grade math at a fair amount of depth, not just based on syntactic identity, but based on semantic interpretation of the formula. You can grade work that's considerably more in-depth. Anything that has a structured form as an output, be it the output of a computer program, a computer model of a physical system, or even an Excel spreadsheet. As long as you know what the output is supposed to be and where to find the different pieces, you could actually now grade this automatically so that you can grade work that has a fair amount of depth. But here's an interesting thing that we discovered. We put this in primarily as a scalability mechanism. That is, as a way of grading students' work at scale. Turned out that it has an enormous benefit beyond that. Because what happens when you have the opportunity to, when you submit an assignment here, is that you get your feedback immediately. Now compare that to the traditional submission in a college class where you submit the work and then maybe if the TAs get around to it, 2 weeks later you get it back. By that point the class has moved on, you look at your grade and say, darn it, I got 70 out of 100, that's too bad, and you stick it in your binder and that's the end of it. Here, because you get the immediate feedback, it turns it into a computer game. The student gets the answer and says, what? 70 out of 100? I can do better than that. And they resubmit. And you can see that in this result over here. This is the distribution of grades on the first submission of a piece of work. You can see it's broad. And on the right, you can see the last submission of that same piece of work, and it's considerably higher and very tightly clustered, which basically indicates that the vast majority of the students got a perfect or close to perfect score. Now, of course, you're sitting there saying, well, so what? You put a monkey next to the keyboard, you let them try often enough, eventually they're going to get a good grade, right? Does it actually indicate that they've learned something? So the answer is, it seems that the answer is yes. That is, let's not check how well the students did on this problem set. Let's check how they do on the next one, which is actually on a different topic. And it turns out that on the next one, the students who engage in this mastery learning do better than the ones who didn't. So it actually improves learning outcomes down the line and not just on this problem set. So that, I think, is a real indication of the value of auto-grading and the immediate feedback that it enables. Now, this, of course, only takes you so far. Because as you start thinking about, well, okay, what about the humanities? What about business and medicine? I mean, you can't auto-grade things that don't have a single right answer, or, you know, at least a clearly defined set of right answers. And so in order to address that, we put in place a mechanism called peer grading. Peer grading is where students are, once they submit their work, are given a grading rubric or set of criteria that are defined by the instructor very carefully. And the students then are trained in the use of that rubric and then are allowed to go and grade the work of other students in the class. And each piece of work is graded by 5 students. So that you get a certain amount of robustness and also feedback from 5 different people. And it turns out that if the grading rubric is well defined, then it actually works really well. So this is from the Princeton sociology class. This is the x-axis is the teacher score, the y-axis is the peer score, and here the TAs in that class did an absolutely monumental task of grading, I think, 1,200 different final exams of essay questions in sociology. And it was a hard final. I looked at it. It was not regurgitation. And you can see that there is a very, very tight correlation between the scores that the TA assigned and the scores that the students assigned, suggesting that peer grading, when carefully constructed, is actually an effective grading strategy. Now, the other aspect of this, though, is that this really allows you to grade effectively a very broad range of different types of work. So here, for example, is the Wharton design class, where the assignment was a semester-long class a project that started out with a problem specification, moved on to a prototype, and then finally an actual artifact. And you can see here 3 of the designs that were among the many to achieve a perfect final score in the class. And you can see that the students actually came up with some really great designs that are, you know, there's a laptop table with a vent and a little place for the cords. There is something that I've often wished I've had in hotel rooms where there's never a piece of furniture next to the power outlet. So where do you put your cell phone to charge? And there's it's true, isn't it? And then there is a space-efficient work desk. And if you think about this, the students came up with these designs because they had access to a piece of feedback from their fellow students at every single stage of the process. So by the end of the course, they had gotten 40 different piece of feedback from 40 different students, which really helped inspire their design. Now, one interesting note is I picked these, I promise, because I like their look. It's only later that I noticed that they came from 3 different continents. The other final interesting point about peer grading is that it turns out that this too has incredible learning benefits that we didn't expect going in. Because if you think about the peer grading process, somebody tackles the peer grading after they finished trying to do the problem on their own. And so their minds are primed. They just finished thinking about this. They thought about this solution, that solution. They picked this one. And all of a sudden, they see 5 others that maybe they didn't think about and can evaluate how that compares to their own question, to their own solution. And it's really a way, I think, of teaching people a first step towards creativity by showing them that the same problem can be tackled in different ways. And this is such an effective learning strategy that many of our instructors who first taught using peer grading on Coursera simply for the scalability purposes are now adopting it into their on-campus instruction because of the benefits to learning. I'm going to skip past this. So this gives rise to the next level, to the final pillar of the student experience, which is that of community. The one thing that doesn't scale is instructor time for interacting with students. For those of us who've taught large classes, it's hard enough to interact with 100 students. it's impossible to interact meaningfully with 10,000 students. So the way in which we do this is we crowdsource the interaction. Instead of having all of the answers come from the voice of God that we heard earlier when we came into this room, rather the interaction comes from other students in the class. So students ask questions. Questions are ranked up and down. Other students, so that the best ones bubble to the top. Answers are provided by other students. Answers are also ranked up and down, so the best answers bubble to the top. And so you actually get very significant amount of interaction, often at a much greater level of detail than you would get from an instructor, because there's a lot of experts in a class of 10,000, and they're motivated and have more time than your average instructor to give really great answers. And so we get comments like this from students that tell us that, in fact, this is a more interactive and collaborative experience than many that they've had in face-to-face instruction. And here's an interesting counterintuitive note. It turns out that larger class, everybody talks about the benefits of small classes. It turns out large classes offer benefits too, at least once you get beyond a certain size. X-axis is number of active users in the class. Y-axis is the amount of time it takes for a student to get their question answered. More students in the class? Faster response time. So this is a place where we actually now strive towards having a class that's at least a certain size before we launch it, because larger is better. The other aspect of community emerged organically on the platform. So we now have close to 2,500 communities in, I think, 1,900 cities around the world, where people get together once a week to study the material because they feel like they could use the extra help and support. They meet at coffee shops, in businesses, in people's houses, and we've been told by many, many students that without this, they would not have been able to pass the class. So that brings me to the final part of the user experience, which is the credential at the end. So what does this credential look like? This is credentials 0.1. This is what Stanford let us offer in the very first batch of courses. It is a letter signed by the instructor. You'll notice that the Stanford only appears at the affiliation, and in fact there's a lot of legal boilerplate at the bottom saying, this is not a Stanford class, it's nothing like a Stanford class, it doesn't confer Stanford credit, and furthermore we have no idea who the student is. And, okay, nevertheless, the somewhat vacuous credential has been used by students to get in line for jobs that they would not otherwise have been eligible for, and in some cases to get college credit at institutions that they were already enrolled in. So the University of Helsinki, for example, on a regular basis gave credit for completed Coursera courses. And there's some universities in the United States that did the same thing. They don't advertise it on their website, but it happens anyway. This is credentials 0.1. Credentials 1.0 we put in place in January of 2012. It's an attempt to get rid of some of that legal boilerplate at the bottom. So this is an identity authenticated track, which the students enroll in about a second or third week of the course. And it effectively is a commitment on their part, not only to do the course, but also to do it under the real identity. So what happens is they submit a government-issued picture ID, say a passport. It's compared to their webcam image. At the same time, they create a biometric profile that uses keystrokes. So it turns out that when I type a phrase, it's actually going to be very different than if President Aoun types the same phrase. And it's very difficult to forge. And so you could actually figure out if a student then submits work next week, who it is that's sitting at the keyboard. Is it they or is it somebody else? And so it turns out that when you do that, now we've addressed the issue of identity verification. There's a certain level of academic integrity. And so now the institutions that we're working with are willing to let us provide a certificate that's still not credit-bearing, but that bears the university brand, and that's something that's very meaningful to people. And we've had several thousand people opt into this even since January. And it's not a very costly thing. It costs about $30, $40, $50, depending on the course. But because we believe in open-access education, and some people in sub-Saharan Africa don't have $40 or $50, we also put in place a financial aid option, which means that if somebody needs the credential and can't afford it, they fill out a financial aid application and they get it for free. Currently, about 20% of our students are financial aid, and we think that that's just fine. Here's an interesting aspect of this that I'm not sure we were necessarily expecting, but came out nevertheless. Retention of students in the signature track is considerably higher than retention of other students. Now, that by itself is not surprising. I mean, if you came in committing to, you know, you want to get the credential, then obviously you're more likely to get the credential. So the bar on the left, the fact that the blue bar is so much higher than the red bar, that's not surprising. I think what's more interesting is the bar on the far right. The bar on the far right represents people who said that they come in committed to completing the course. They're going to watch every single video, do every single assignment, and nevertheless, signature track completes at a much higher rate than non-signature track. So it looks like having some skin in the game actually encourages people to complete the class, which maybe is not that surprising. Okay, the final aspect of credentialing, which is also very new, it's in January, is working with the American Council of Education, where President Aoun is also, you're the president of the board, right? After last month, I'm not up to date, was the president of the board. The American Council for Education, as some of you might realize, is an umbrella organization for all U.S. academic institutions, very long, venerable tradition. One of the things that they do that most people are not familiar with is the ACE credit program. It's a program that was initiated after World War II for the purpose of helping veterans who came home from the war get college credit for some of the learning that they did while being in service. For example, some of them learned to become electronics engineers as part of their military service. It would be nice if that was translated into college credit so they didn't have to repeat the work. And so the American Council for Education has a tradition of taking typically small face-to-face classes and evaluating them for credit equivalency. Mostly it's classes in the military, but more recently there's also been classes in industry and government. And so in January they took five of our classes as a pilot and evaluated them for credit equivalency, and all five were declared credit equivalent. So now if a student completes this class successfully under this track, they have the opportunity of transferring that credit into an academic institution in which they subsequently enrolled, so that they have the opportunity of gaining credit for the learning that they got in this online format, which is, I think, a really exciting development. Okay, so now I'm going to take a step up and talk about two higher level, I think, opportunities that emerge from this. The first is just the data. The data here is really staggering in its opportunity, because we collect every single event that happens. Every time a student pauses the video, rewinds, fast forwards, submits a quiz, submits a forum post, reads a forum post, it's all recorded, and it's recorded at the scale of tens of thousands of students. So you can learn a tremendous amount from this about what works and what doesn't. So I'm going to give just two examples of that for, in the interest of time. The first is in the context of a particular course. This is a distribution of wrong answers in one of Andrew's machine learning exercises. Each little cross is a one-off wrong answer, a unique way of being wrong. The big crosses are common wrong answers. So the one on the top left, for example, is where 2,000 students gave the exact same wrong answer in this infinite space. Now, if two students in a class of 100 give the same wrong answer, you'd never notice. But when it's 2,000, it kind of jumps out at you. So Andrew and his TAs went in, looked at some of these assignments, understood the basis for the misconception. And so now every time a student falls into that bucket, their answer falls on that cross, they don't just get a, sorry, you're wrong. They get a, sorry, you're wrong, and you might want to think about this way. So that it allows us to personalize the learning experience to the particular mistake that the student's making. And doing so by having a large enough database of answers to learn from. The next opportunity can come up at a much higher level, at the level of understanding things about basic human learning and what works and what doesn't. So here's a question that's been asked and discussed in the literature in a number of papers, taking opposite positions in many cases. Does showing the instructor's face in the video help by making it more human, or hurt by distracting the student from the material? Well, now we can try it. So the way in which we tried it is something called A-B testing. Some of you might have heard of A-B testing, but it's Silicon Valley jargon, so many of you haven't. But even if you haven't heard of A-B testing, you've participated in A-B testing. Because every time you log into Google or Facebook or any one of those other online platforms, there is usually about a 5% chance that you're in the B group. The B group is the one that gets a different user experience than the A group, and then they measure performance based on whatever metrics they care about, for example, click-through rates. And if the B group is doing better than the A group, they'll know that in a matter of hours or days because of the large numbers that are involved, and then the entire site switches over to the B group if that one's doing better. We've never been able to have that kind of rapid turnaround and iterative improvement in the context of pedagogy. Because if we have a really great idea on how to teach better, what do? Well, we write a grant proposal to the NSF. And then 6 months later, it comes back and they say, no, we can't fund it, but we'll give you a small pilot project on 5 people. And then if that works, we might give you an extra round of funding down the line. And it's 10 years before you finally get to write the paper. And then, you know, God knows if anybody actually reads it. Here you can now test pedagogy in the same way that Google or Facebook iteratively improve their site. So here's that A-B test. And I'm sure you're all sitting there waiting for me to tell you whether showing the instructor's face improves learning outcomes or not. But I won't. And the reason I won't is because we actually had to stop the experiment in the middle because the students in the B group complained bitterly at not seeing the instructor's face. So we don't know if it actually improves learning outcomes, but we know what the students like. So, but here's another one that I will tell you about. This is not actually an A-B test. It's an A-B-C-D-E-F-G-H test. And it's intended to measure the question of, does sending student reminder emails, letting them know that an assignment is due, does that help student retention or not? Well, so we tried that, and we tried that with a different set of combinations. So here is the email, and if you can read the font, it has 3 different components in it. What assignments have already taken place that you've done? What's coming up, and this infographic at the bottom, like what deadlines are coming up, and the infographic at the bottom that says how far along in the course are you. So 3 different things, so 8 different combinations. That's why it's an ABCDEFGH test. And here's the interesting thing. Of the different 8 different combinations, only one actually improves retention. Furthermore, the worst one isn't the one that has, isn't the empty email that has none of these. That's the baseline email that has none of these 3 pieces of content. It's kind of like a vacuous, hey, how are you doing kind of email, is the second worst. The worst one is the one that has only the deadlines, because students don't like to be nagged. It's only that one that has all 3 of them that actually improves performance. Now, this is very anecdotal. It's one class, and obviously one needs to do it more broadly, but it illustrates the strength of this methodology. Which brings us to the final piece of this opportunity, which is improving learning outcomes. So there's 2 ways in which we think this might improve learning outcomes. One happens in the online world and one happens in the physical world. The online world, we go back all the way to a paper from 30 years ago by renowned educational researcher Benjamin Bloom, who studied 3 populations and the distribution of achievement scores. This is the distribution for people taught in a lecture-based class. Not even a large lecture. It had about 35 people in it. You see the standard bell-shaped distribution. This next bell-shaped distribution is people who were taught in a lecture-based class but in a mastery learning format, which means you couldn't move to the next topic before demonstrating competence in the previous one. You can see a full standard deviation, or sigma, improvement in performance in Bloom's results relative to this red curve. The green curve are people who had a one-on-one human tutor. And you can see yet another standard deviation, or sigma, in performance improvement. Now, what does a 2 sigma performance improvement correspond to in real life? If you take the midpoint of this curve as a performance threshold, so that because it's the median, half of the class is going to be above and half is going to be below. And you take that same threshold of performance and apply it to the green curve, 98% of the students are going to be above that curve. So here's, think about that. It's an intervention that if we could only implement it, would make 98% of our students be above average. Lake will be gone in action. But we can't. Hence the title of Benjamin Bloom's paper, because as a society, we can't afford to provide an individual human tutor to every student. And that's why Bloom calls it the 2 sigma problem. But now we can change the question. The question is now, if we can't afford a tutor, but maybe we can afford a tablet, or at least a smartphone. So now the question is, can we use technology to get us from the blue curve to the green, to the red curve, and ultimately the green curve? So the nice thing about the red curve is that computers are really good at mastery. Because you see, they don't get bored at showing you the same video 5 times. They don't even get judgmental and say, how come you're not getting it? What's wrong with you? And so it's actually quite reasonable to achieve mastery here. The green curve is more elusive, and I think it's a really interesting challenge on how we can get there. But I think there's a lot of steps that we've taken towards personalization that are steps in the right direction. The next place where we can improve things is in the physical world, what we do with the students who are fortunate enough to be in a physical classroom with an actual live instructor. Or are they that fortunate? Here's an interesting quote from Edwin Slosson, a 19th century educator, who says, the college is a place where a professor's lecture notes go straight to the student's lecture notes without passing through the brains of either. Not the kindest description of a lecture, but maybe not unwarranted. So maybe what we ought to do is go from this to this. Students get the content in a much more interactive, engaging format, and then come to class to actually engage actively with the instructor, doing problem solving, creative thinking, debate, discussion, and all those things that we just don't have time for in your typical lecture class. So I think this is a real opportunity for us to improve learning outcomes in dramatic ways, and I'm going to skip past this. So to summarize this, Christian Terwisch is one of our Coursera instructors from the Wharton Business School who teaches operations management. His final lecture is a case study of Coursera. It's on YouTube. I highly recommend it. It's very insightful. So Christian says that that instruction is always a trade-off between faculty productivity in terms of the number of students you can teach in a certain amount of time and the student learning outcomes. Individual instruction, as you get in office hours, would be at the top left there. Traditional lecture-based instruction would be over there. He claims that MOOCs provide us with a whole new frontier of this trade-off curve. And you can use this frontier in different ways. You can use this frontier to keep student learning outcomes the same, but decrease costs. For example, by offering one of these online courses to hundreds of thousands of people around the world at effectively a zero marginal cost per student. Or you can use it to improve student learning outcomes while keeping instructor effort fixed by moving, say, to a blended learning format. Or you could explore different points along the curve, and it's really up to an institution to figure out where it wants to be. So I'm now going to just summarize and sort of take a big step up and talk about back to education for everyone. I'm going to talk about two different ways of breaking down our population. This is one. Currently, over 80% of our students actually have a degree of some kind or another, a bachelor's degree or a master's degree. Now, partially it's because we couldn't offer credit until recently, and so that biases this. But really, I think this is also indicative of the fact that this really empowers people to become lifelong learners. Because right now, the options for a working adult to continue their education in a meaningful, high-quality way are very, very limited. And this really provides them access to something that allows them to get booster shots of education that are so important in this day and age, where what you learned in college 20 years ago is really not enough anymore to keep you a productive member of society. So I think this is one of the big opportunities. The second big opportunity, maybe even bigger, is this graph over here. Only a third of our students are in the United States. About 28% are in Europe. The rest are in all other countries around the world, every single country around the world. 40% of our students are in what the State Department defines to be the developing world. So I think there's a real opportunity here to take the kind of education that's been available until now only to a very privileged few and turn it into a basic human right. So to conclude with an anecdote, in September, I attended the launch of the Education First Initiative of the United Nations in New York. And they were talking about how you travel in Africa. This is an initiative that's intended to offer education to all students everywhere, to children everywhere. And they were talking about if you go to a refugee camp in the Congo, where people are living in little grass huts on a cup of food a day, and you ask them what they most want, they don't typically say more food. They don't say better shelter. They say they want a better education for their children because they know that that is the only way for them to break out of the cycle of poverty and really offer their children a chance at a better life. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Daphne. We're delighted to see you again here. We organized a day at the Brookings, and the night before we had a dinner to discuss disruptions and innovations in higher education, and the next day we had a full day to discuss the same topic. And I can tell you, Daphne is very good with her answers, but she welcomes short questions. So the format is very simple. We're going to have very short questions. Longer answers, and try to be as interactive as possible. We have people on the web tweeting questions, and I think Sean Gallagher is going to be asking those questions. So let me start with one. You know, I was talking with Daphne, and she said, look, I speak maybe 2-4 times per week, therefore I have seen them all.
all kinds of questions. So if you want to surprise her, work on that, you know, but not personal. Let's look at your model.
Okay.
You have decided to go to with the, you know, universities that have been established, and therefore, when we look at credentialings, the universities cannot give the credentialing because it waters down what their brand, that's mm-hmm. their approach. And you told me that we're not in the, you know, content production model. You don't produce that. So suppose that you look at it differently and you say, we are going to provide credentialing. Mm-hmm. That who are, you know, and therefore it may move you into the product development mode. Mm-hmm. Why don't you do it?
Because there is no way for us to become content experts in every single discipline that higher education offers. I think, you know, there's the surprising success of Sal Khan, who demonstrated the ability to teach a lot of high school content across a range of disciplines in a remarkably effective way. But there's no way even for somebody as smart as Sal to teach psychology, philosophy, linguistics, medicine, business. And so who am I to pretend to that level of expertise? Now, I guess I could go and try and recruit instructors and vet them and so on and so forth. It's long and complicated, and universities have done it so well. Why should I try and replicate their effort?
Now, do they, because you're working with universities along these dimensions, are they limiting you? You know, if you go with the individual instructors mm-hmm. and you get the best instructors wherever they are, then you are free to give your credentialing, because aren't you also creating a kind of two-tier credentialing? Those that are, you know, if I'm from Duke, I'll get my credentialing from Duke, and otherwise I'll get the certificate. Mm-hmm. You know, you heard that before. People raised it. So what's your take on that?
My take on it is that for the vast majority of our population, which are currently the continuing education people, the fact that a credential is not credit-bearing is completely insignificant. They're never going to go back and get a degree. So the less formal certificate that we can offer them at a much lower price point, at much greater flexibility that fits into their lifestyle, is just fine as far as they're concerned. For the population that is not yet that do not yet have a degree, I agree with you that there is a certain question there of how do you get them some kind of credential that furthers their goal of getting an associate or bachelor's or master's degree. And I think that's why we started to work with the AC in order to help facilitate that.
Yeah. Incidentally, I mean, it's interesting when we started talking, you know, it's clear that some people were very nervous about that, the mm-hmm. assessment. And, you know, we were discussing that with at our previous meeting, AC is assessing the courses. So people are saying, some universities, well, who is an ACE? Why do I have to submit my courses to mm-hmm. ACE? You know, because in a way you are relinquishing some of your prerogatives from this perspective. And also we are seeing some other kinds of resistance based on that. Mm-hmm. So why did you need the assessment at all?
Because it facilitates for our students the opportunity to take this course, their success in this course, and turn it into a tangible benefit for them, which is the ability to move one step closer towards a college degree. There's some interesting numbers that I know you're familiar with that says that I think there is something like 60-70% of our students do not complete their degree in the same college that they started out registering for. Many of them just drop out and come back later. So a vast majority of our students here in the United States right now are actually non-traditional learners. They're not in the 18 to 24-year-old range. Many of them drop out and have some amount of college and would like to come back. But they're scared because it's hard to come back when you have very mm-hmm. little. So this is a way for people to come back to college and complete their degree because it allows them to make progress towards it in a much less threatening way. This is almost risk-free. When you enroll in a college, you put your money up front. And if it turns out that you didn't succeed, well, too bad. I mean, your money's gone, right? Here, you can enroll, you can try it for a few weeks, you see how well you're doing, and if you feel like you're doing well, then you kind of pay for the proctored final exam and so on that the ACE requires.
But it's a much, much, much lower cost and much lower risk for people. And I think it's a way to give people confidence on how to come back to school.
Before we open the floor for discussion, I know that you hear constantly about the dropout rate. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we know that for the time being, there's a huge dropout rate.
Yeah.
And therefore, why do you think it's happening and how are you going to tackle that?
So I think that the way to tackle it is to first understand the extent to which it's not a problem. So the truth is that most of the students who enroll in a MOOC have no intent to finish it at all. This is something that makes it very different from a traditional college class. If somebody enrolls in a college class, it is with the declared intent of seeing it to completion. If they don't, then they've failed, or the system has failed, somebody's failed. Most of these students are just exploring, they're browsing. So many of them treat this as analogous to you go to the library, you pick up a book off the bookshelf, you say, oh, that looks interesting, let me read a few chapters. And they take it home, and when the loan period is over, they bring it back having read the first five chapters. Is that a failure of the book? No, it's just they never had the intent to do all the homeworks and finish the final exam corresponding to the book. So I think once you calibrate for that, our rates don't become nearly as bad. So, for example, if you look at the students who submit the first meaningful homework in a course, a programming assignment, a peer-graded assessment, something like that, completion rate for that's about 45%.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So that's a very different number already. The completion rate for signature track, which is a real declaration of intent to finish, is about 75 to 80%, which, again, is really not so bad. So I think it's important. Now, of course, we'd like to get that up to the 90s, clearly, the signature track. But it's nothing close to the, only 5% of people finish the course. That's true, because only 10% of them ever intend to.
Great. Let's open the floor for discussion. David, please. We have a microphone because everything you say will be on the web. So,
hi, I wanted to ask you a quick question about a feature that I'd like to use that I didn't hear you mention, but that I think is potentially scalable. The reason that is, I think that is, we do work in my lab with Facebook. So when you're saying A/B testing, I get A/B testing every week. But anyway, here's the question: in my classes, I like to not just have people work together randomly, but to select people based on certain features.
Right.
And so at Facebook, one thing we do is there's this metric called coefficient, which you can use to give a parametric analysis, right, to what features they have in common. And so I could never assign 10,000 people, but do you collect demographic information such that I could put in parameters that I want and place people automatically into groups that will give me the mix that I want?
So there's two parts to the answer to the question. The first is collection of demographics, and the answer is that we have a profile, but it's optional in terms of people's willingness to fill it out. So we have demographics for some people, but not others, because we don't like forcing our students to do something they don't want to do. The second question is about group formation. And that's a feature that has been requested very often, as you might expect, something that a lot of instructors want. It turns out that doing group formation in this format is considerably more challenging than in a typical classroom because of the dropout rate that we just heard about. If you start out putting, five people in a group, by week four, there's going to be just one of them. So you're going to have to repopulate the groups and restructure them every single week. So I think there's some interesting design questions as well as engineering challenges in getting this to work right. And we're still trying to figure out how to do this, but it's definitely very much on our horizon.
Sean, let me move to Sean, and then I'll move to this side and go back to Lisa.
Excellent. First question from Twitter is, will Coursera impact private education more so than public? And will the impact be competitive or lead to Coursera's integration?
I think that there is going to be an impact on institutions that I'm not sure partitions along the private versus public line as much as it partitions along the lines of institutions that are willing to understand what's happening, embrace this new paradigm, and figure out that their value proposition to their students cannot be about content, because content is about to become free and ubiquitous. And it better not be just about accreditation, because that's a fairly lame reason to provide. It's a fairly lame value that you're providing to your students. That's the only value you're providing. So I think institutions need to think about, what am I giving to my students? And it varies. Some private institutions give amazing value to their students, and some public institutions give amazing value to their students. And I think it's just important for each institution to sort of enunciate exactly what it is that they're doing and clarify that to their students. So that was the first half of the question. The second half was, will it be competitive or not? I certainly hope it'll be synergistic. We have elected from the very beginning to work in partnership with universities as opposed to as a competitor. We do not predict nor want the demise of education. We think it's, U.S. education is one of the crowning jewels of the United States. And we would hope that what would happen is that institutions will start embracing this mode of education in a blended learning format that I talked about earlier, and that'll improve the quality of education for on-campus students and not just for the students in the general public.
Great. This side, do I hear? Yes, over there we have a question.
First of all, I took a course on Coursera in Python and greatly enjoyed it.
Good.
This is a slightly
The Toronto
more,
one or the Rice one?
The Toronto one,
okay.
And I'm going to do another one in 2 weeks.
Good.
The question I have is slightly more direct, which is, to a great extent, Coursera seems to be relying on cross-subsidization from traditional university tuitions and endowments to supply its content while simultaneously eroding the market for those tuitions and endowments.
Mm-hmm.
To what extent are you concerned that as you eventually need to monetize Coursera, you'll have difficulty doing so having introduced it at a $0 price point?
Okay, so first of all, I actually take exception to some of the assumptions that you made that we're eroding the market for these institutions of higher education, because I think that, as I mentioned, the institutions that are providing a value to their students are really an amazing experience, and one that most students, almost any student, would benefit from having that experience as opposed to taking it online if they only have that opportunity. And I would urge any student who has the option of coming to Northeastern and being here as opposed to taking the class purely online to do that. So I think that's part of the answer to the question. The second half is about the zero price point and the monetization. We are exploring what is called in Silicon Valley jargon the freemium model, which is that you provide a basic free service and then there's premium add-ons that students can elect to take part of. Primarily, this is a moral decision, because we feel that if you started charging for content, you will put this content out of reach from the people who need it the most, be it the people in sub-Saharan Africa who don't have a credit card, or even the people here in the United States that do have a credit card and could afford $5 or $10, but it's too much trouble for them to sort of, it's too much friction, and they'll just go back to playing computer games or being on Facebook. Mm-hmm. So we specifically didn't want to introduce friction into the learning process. I think that the premium, but that having been said, the freemium model seems to be working very effectively for organizations like Google, Facebook, Zynga, LinkedIn. So as a business strategy, it doesn't necessarily seem like it's flawed. Signature Track, which launched less than 3 months ago, is doing actually quite well revenue-wise for something so new. So I think we're optimistic that we will be able to monetize this without having to charge students for content.
Daphne, could you explain why you went for a for-profit model instead of a not-for-profit? You heard it many times.
Yep.
I heard you answering that. I think it would be good, given as a follow-up to a question, to explain that.
I think the short answer is because no one was willing to write me a check for $60 million. And we tried to fundraise for this when we were still doing this as part of a Stanford project. And, you know, Google gave us $75,000 and Intel gave us $25,000 and the Stanford, you know, endowment gave us $125,000. So, and you could do it, but you could do it on a shoestring budget and it would fail because it would not be a good experience for anybody. And so we decided that we wanted to do this well, and the only way to do this well was in this was as a for-profit. But honestly, we believe that it's not a moral sin to do well while doing good. And that we can continue to live up to the educational mission of the company while still bringing in enough revenue to make this a sustainable proposition for us, for the universities who get revenue back from this effort, and for the investors.
Great. Lisa.
So I'd like to ask you a more philosophical question,
sure.
I think. So immediately I was struck by thoughts of Thomas Jefferson and his beliefs about higher education and how it creates better citizens,
mm-hmm.
in part because, you know, we live in a conflict-ridden world, and the basis of conflict resolution is perspective-taking,
mm-hmm.
and this is something that university yep. courses are, right? So it's not too much of a jump to believe that this could have a role in, you know, world peace. I mean,
mm-hmm.
just to, yeah. On the other hand, I think about my own discipline, and which is psychology, and I worry a little bit about intellectual imperialism
mm-hmm.
in the following way. You know, in all of our textbooks and everything we teach, we have a model of the mind, which separates emotions and cognitions and perceptions. So our feelings, our thoughts, and how we perceive the world. And this is very pervasive.
We have to be short.
Yeah, sorry. But it's not the only model. And in psychology, all of the textbooks are based on this model.
So what's the question?
So the question is this, do you worry about intellectual imperialism?
Yeah.
On the one hand, you know,
okay.
balancing.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is actually two questions in one. So the first half is that, yes, I actually do believe that this has tremendous opportunity in improving fundamental problems, including world peace. So specifically, if you look at the problems that plague the developing world, be it infant mortality, malnutrition, unemployment, extremism, AIDS, and you correct for all other factors and you stratify by education, the more educated people are, the less these problems exist. And so I think there is a tremendous opportunity here by educating people to at least reduce the prevalence of some of these problems. The issue of intellectual imperialism has come up before, and I think that people are worried about, well, are you going to have only one version of a class, and so that's going to be the version, and everyone's going to learn from that. I don't believe that's any more true than it is for textbooks. I think that, as you said, there's multiple textbooks. In this case, unfortunately, they all present the same view, but that I can't help that. But you can easily imagine that, you know, you'd have 10, 12 different psychology classes that present different perspectives, sometimes from different cultures, because specifically we went in a multicultural route so that you could have different perspectives.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that one of the other things you're going to see, which I'm actually very excited about, is the long tail. So think about what happened to journalism. There used to be lots and lots of newspapers. Now there's a lot fewer, so you can say there's a loss of diversity. But at the same time, there's now thousands and thousands of bloggers that in the traditional model would never have had an audience in their hometown, because there would be five people who were interested in the topic, but now there's 5,000, and it's enough to sustain them. I think the same thing is going to happen with courses. You're going to have these niche courses that are very distinctive in their perspective, that would not have had an audience in any single institution, but now, because of the worldwide reach, have enough for this to be a viable course.
The quiet side, on this side, I see like here many hands. Do you have any question here on this side? Otherwise, we'll go to Sean, back to Sean for a Twitter question. Are you ready? Do you have the mic?
I'm ready, yes.
Great.
Another question from Twitter. How do you respond to people who are skeptical of online education?
You know, there's a lot fewer of those than there used to be, I'm glad to say, although they still exist. I don't know how to answer that question, because people are skeptical about different things. Some people are skeptical about academic integrity, and we have ways to address that. Some people are skeptical about learning outcomes, but frankly, I think the results that we have with people succeeding in courses that are as challenging as the best institutions can put out, people without any kind of formal education leading that, nevertheless succeed in these courses, I think that speaks for itself.
If the day people are no longer skeptical, Daphne may be out of a job. I mean, she's capitalizing on disruption. By definition, every disruption will have skeptical people. So Sri, you cannot speak without a microphone.
So we teach a course in nanomedicine, which is broadcast to partner institutions in Alabama, Puerto Rico. And what they do is they offer the same course mm-hmm. with instructors over there.
Great.
So there are three elements to this, which I think I'd like you to comment on. One is that we have the specialized content, which they don't have.
Mm-hmm.
We have the credentialing immediately because, you know, they're offering the course, and, mm-hmm. and it's perfectly valid for their students.
Yep.
Now, I'll just add that we're using WebEx, but perhaps we can use
So what's the question?
So the question is, what is your...
He's much stricter than I am.
Yeah.
How do you see this, by the way? Is this sort of a blended
yes.
MOOC that you,
yes.
Alluded to, but
yes.
didn't quite... Yeah.
So, in fact, this is one of the big opportunities that I see, that an institution will put together a course that is really high quality. Maybe they're uniquely qualified to teach it, or maybe it's just a really great introductory calculus class. And other institutions will look at that and say, that is a really great presentation of this material that maybe I can't offer to my students because I don't have the qualified instructor. Maybe it's just a really great course that's better than what I could offer. They will adopt it, and they will wrap and local instructor around it to sort of do guidance, mentoring, question answering, maybe some additional assessments, in-class discussions, and they will provide the credit. And I think it's a model that we're going to see increasingly more and more of, and in the not-too-distant future.
Can we do that through Coursera?
Yes. One is done. The one is done.
The answer is yes.
Because we, you know, could you repeat the question? Because
okay.
they didn't hear it on.
The question is, can we do that through Coursera? And we've had a lot of institutions come and say that they yeah. want to do exactly that with our content.
Tim, I know you'll be quick.
Yes. Hi, Daphne. Good to see you. I'm wondering if you can comment on this debate about liberal arts education versus more applied education. Mm-hmm. And how that fits into your model.
You know, people initially told us that we couldn't teach liberal arts on Coursera, or you couldn't you couldn't teach it online, you couldn't teach it as a MOOC, you couldn't teach it at scale, whatever. I think all those predictions have turned out to be false. Some of our most successful classes have been in the liberal arts, in the humanities, in the social sciences, in the arts. I think peer grading is actually a really amazing experience for the students who engage with it, and that provides a way of scaling this up into this format in a way that actually adds as opposed to detracts from the experience.
The last question here.
Oh, good.
Three good quick, that it's the last.
Three
or good
quick, three
that
quick
it's
ones
you.
In. So I have 8-year-old twins. Okay.
I have an 8 and 10-year-old. Okay.
In today's world, a decade from now, I'd have to have about north of $500,000 for college saved. So, in your opinion, given what's happening, how much do I need to save for college for them?
Yeah.
Two. How many?
You have one question.
Oh, well, and how many physical institutions do you think will be left for them to choose from?
Boy. I think prices will have to come down. I don't know how much they will come down. But I think what's more important is the quality will go up. And that's something that I think we try and emphasize when we talk to people, that a lot of the failure modes, and let me speak for a moment not to private education, which is where you're going to have to pay the $500,000, but to public education, a lot of the costs that we're seeing there are simply people who are not succeeding. They come in, they take the class, they fail it, or maybe they scrape through and they don't get it well enough to be a basis for the next class down the line. And I think that we can, by improving quality, we can help address some of those problems. And by doing so, I think we will first directly decrease costs to the institution by all of these failures or semi-failures, but also I think just improve overall GDP, if you will, by having more people who are equipped to participate in a 21st century economy. So I don't know what this says about the tuitions of private institutions. I think it's going to be an interesting thing to watch going forward. How many institutions are we going to have? That my crystal ball is not good enough for that one.
Yeah. Let me, Daphne, ask you the final question
okay.
from this perspective. Clearly, you are disrupting a system.
Transforming.
And disrupting, too, which is good. And as you said, if people, you know, embrace these opportunities, they will thrive.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, you know, that's your answer. But now, if I want to disrupt you, how am I going to go about it?
I'm not going to tell you that.
We believe in academic freedom.
That's right, and I have the freedom not to answer that
so
question.
So what keeps you awake at night?
Um,
Actually, I think...
I don't think so. Did you hear that?
No, I didn't.
He's quipping edX. I don't think that you're afraid of edX. We discussed it together.
No.
So tell them why, but then tell us what keeps you awake at night.
Let's see. Should I answer the why I'm not
Whatever.
Afraid of edX?
I believe in academic freedom, too.
Let's see. Why does edX not keep me awake at night? Well... Let's see. First of all, because I think it's healthy to have multiple entrants into a space. It would be unhealthy if there was just the one. From a much more pragmatic perspective, frankly, we're much, much bigger on every single dimension. Number of students is about 5 times, number of courses, number of institutions. So I think so far we're doing fine on that front. It's not edX that keeps me up at night. I think if there's one thing that does keep me up at night is the question that was just asked. That is, how do we navigate these treacherous waters of transforming the system in a way that doesn't break it? Because I really believe in this system. I think it's not that it can't be improved, but I think it's a great thing that we've put together, we society, in terms of the higher education. And it's very easy when you have a transformative technology, to give people who don't understand ammunition on things that could lead to very bad outcomes. So various politicians who see a silver bullet that fixes all of the world's problems and can, you know, reduce the cost of education to nothing so you don't have to subsidize it anymore and so on and so forth. I think it's really important to try and navigate this in a way that prevents that... aims towards the good outcomes that I think could emerge from this without giving people the opportunity to derail it into the really bad ones. So.
Well, thank you very much, Daphne. We're delighted to have you here today. Thank you. Thank you. Great.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.